Yeah, God bless you, Rob Wood here of Rob Wood's Ministries. I want to release a message I believe God's given to me on how critical timing is. You see, if the baby's born prematurely, studies show most of the time the baby is not healthy as if it were born on the due date or around the due date. And if the baby's born overdue, also complications could arise. So, you know, there's a trick in the prophetic, and there's four realms in the prophetic, which is timing, delivery, application, and interpretation. Let me say that again. Timing, application, interpretation, and delivery. Now, if you blow it in one, I believe you potentially could blow it in all, but I believe the most critical part is timing, because you don't want to be ahead of God, and then you want to pull the trigger. You don't want to hesitate when God says go for it. Now let's do this. In Habakkuk chapter 2, it says, write the vision, make it plain on tablets. The vision is yet for an appointed time. How many people know when God told Abraham and Sarah you were going to have a baby, it said at the set time Sarah gave birth to the baby. But it was past the point where physically in the natural they could make this happen. So God got the glory. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. At the end it will speak, it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, it will surely come, it will not tarry. Now, we've got to learn to wait upon the Lord, you know. Waiting upon the Lord, I believe, can become a lost art in Christianity. You know, most of my prayer is just contemplation or meditation. Now, let me just tell you, meditation is not a New Age term. That's a term the enemy stole from the church, but we're taking it back. In fact, we've already taken it back. And, you know, that's restoration, but, you know, I love restoration, but why do we give away what's once belonged to us in the first place? But in the book of Joshua, it says, you meditate on his word day and night, you'll be prosperous, you'll have good success. David often said, I meditate on his word, which is the word of God. Now, God told Moses in the 24th chapter in the book of Exodus, he says, come up on the mountain. In other words, come to a higher place spiritually. Come on the mountain. Come to higher heights so you can see from a different perspective and be there. So, you know, Moses is on the mountain. He's just being. And God's called us to be human beings, not human doings. It's out of relationship that we serve God. So Moses is on the mountain and God tells him, just be there in stillness. In contemplation, just be marinate like a fine steak. You know, most steaks, they marinate sometimes for 2 to 3 weeks and they become tender. And then it says, I will now give you the tablets of stone, which were the Ten Commandments, which speaks of instruction and strategy. It says, the glory of God rested on Mount Sinai for 6 days, and on the seventh day, the glory of God fell. And how many people know Moses camped out on the mountain for 40 days. I mean, he didn't want to leave, you know. So I believe the seventh day is the day of rest. It says God worked 6 days, and on the seventh day he rested. Rested from what? From works. The Sabbath day is the seventh day. You know, if you don't eventually come apart, you will come apart. And the Bible says Jesus often withdrew to a lonely place and prayed all night. He got alone with the Father. So I believe the seventh day is the day where we cease from works, and we've got to live in that seventh day, people. You know, it's not about what we can do for God, it's about what God can do through us. I believe the seventh day is the day of favor. I believe the seventh day is where we don't work for God, but God works for us. And you know, how many people would rather have God work for you? Because God can accomplish more for you and through you in a millisecond than you can accomplish in a lifetime of labor. And, you know, Exodus 34, it says, 6 days you shall work, but on the seventh day you shall rest. In plowing time and in harvest time you shall rest. And, you know, I'm thinking in the book of Joshua, God told Joshua, march around the mountain 6 days, march around the walls of Jericho 6 days, once a day. On the seventh day, do it 7 times. And how many people know the seventh day is when the walls of Jericho fell prostrate? They fell straight down. You know, that's almost impossible. I mean, the enemy wasn't blown. He just came tumbling down. And listen to this. 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse 8. Samuel tells Saul, wait for me. But Samuel never came back. And it says in verse 11, Samuel said, "What have you done when I saw that the people were scattered and that you did not come within the days appointed?" Because prior to that, in verse 8, it says, "Then he waited the set time according to Samuel." So Saul gets involved in what's called a burnt offering, a religious activity. He tried to help God out. God doesn't need your help, my friends. He needs your cooperation. We were never around in the book of Genesis before we were even created. So trust me, he knows what he's doing. Verse 12, it says, "I felt compelled and offered a burnt offering." Now listen to this word, compelled. It means to force or to drive. It means I force myself thereof, or so I felt obligated to act. So Saul blamed the people. And he said, the people, you know, little Flip Wilson, the devil made me, the people made me do it. He wasn't willing to take responsibility for his own error and come into alignment and allow God to correct him. And of course, 1 Samuel 15, what an absolute sad story where God rips the kingdom out from Saul and gives it to a man after his own heart by the name of David. So again, the seventh day is the day where we rest from works, where God, we don't work for God. God works for us, and I believe there's a seasoning now. This is key. We wait upon the Lord, and I believe in Exodus, Mount Sinai was a foreshadow of Pentecost because Jesus said, "Wait or tarry in Jerusalem from on high, and then power from on high will come upon the church." So wait or tarry, but never allow your tarrying to be turned into complacency. Never allow your contemplation to be turned into complacency. In other words, don't become complacent, because when God says pull the trigger, you have got to go, because Jesus says, "Go ye therefore into all the world." The anointing is always in the going. Caleb said, "I'm as strong as the day you call. Let me go up at once and possess that mountain." And I believe Elijah said, "See now, the place where we're dwelling is too small. Let us now build a bigger place." So when God speaks enlargement, when he says it's your season, and he's prepared you, he's positioned you, he has aligned you. In 1 Chronicles chapter 20, God told Jehoshaphat, he says, "You don't have to fight this battle, I'll fight it for you." But when the Lord says pull the trigger, you cannot hesitate. You have got to go for it. Because to go over and go past, when the Lord says go for it, you will now lose faith and you'll get into the realm of doubt and you'll begin to think, "God, did you really tell me to do this?" And you, because you hesitated and you did not pull the trigger and the baby wasn't born on time. And when I'm speaking prophetically about a baby being, God's inseminated a vision, not only in his church, but in his individual people on the earth. And I believe all believers are ministers. I believe all believers are called to be evangelists and win souls. All believers are called to be prayer warriors. So I hope this message on timing is ministered to you. It's so critical that you are in the timing of the Lord, which is his perfect will. Because, you know, there is the permissible will of God, but the perfect will of God is the gold. The permissible will of God is the silver. Gold never tarnishes. The silver can tarnish, it can fade, but we have got to learn to be in the perfect timing so heaven can come to earth. God bless you in Jesus' name.